Welcome back, M6 fams, to another episode of Way Back When. We're going to continue our series down in Yorktown today, where we will be at the actual Yorktown Battlefield historical site. I will preface this that this is a straight history video. It's just me taking a look at, with the fam, the Yorktown Battlefield. If you're not a history buff or a history nerd like myself, this video may not be for you. However, if you are, go ahead and enjoy it. Everyone have a magically blessed day.
We are entering historic Yorktown. It says, to the right, the British extended their works outward along the York-Hampton Road, a principal entrance into Yorktown, which they blocked with this hornwork, garrisoned by Colonel Abercrombie's light infantry. And over here, this is British inner defense line. I guess there's a historical tour that we'll figure out. Poppy gave us a DVD. We'll figure out where we need to start for that. Maybe there's a map or something we can pop it in somewhere, so we'll figure this out. Okay, this is the second stop in our adventure. This is where the French batteries were. And this earth and across the street as well, I believe, are the French batteries. Take a look over here. Alright, so we got the whole fam out. Apparently there's some cool stuff to see here. Hopefully it's not a letdown. I would say let's stay off that bridge. Yeah. Should probably where the cannon sat. Like a battery location. Yeah, I can see. Oh yeah. I don't know, there's a cannon right up here, honey. Yep, two of them, wow. One of these are the original pieces of wood.
People just left those cannons right there.
Wow.
There's a gun there too.
Yep.
People just left those cannons
there. Wow. Let's see what this goes to. We're good. Oh yeah. Kind of see across there. You can see where the British earthen, like the British buildup is. So this is the battlefield, basically. And here's another wall that was created. But if you look across there, that's where we were. You can see that's the
all the way over
there. Yeah, that's where the, and so these cannons would shoot across.
Wait.
And be deadly.
Hey, that American flag is for the America.
Yeah, well, now it's there, but it probably wasn't there before. That would be where the British flag was, isn't it? Right there. Standing in a line where the cannons would be firing here. You can see down there, that's kind of where a cannon would be. I think Quinn is officially sleeping now.
No, she's looking down.
She's just angry at the world.
I think she's looking at her feet touching those flowers.
Lots of earthworms. Earth man-made fortifications. Ezra, get in the cannon!
I am the hole!
can see. Just keep looking down. This is the front of what was the French and American line. You can kind of still see flags going that way. And I don't know, that might be a British battery. It might be an American battery, Division 910. That might be what that was talking about, but it kind of looks like it's going that way a little bit. So we'll get over there here in a second. You can see over there, there's Yorktown. There's the Earthwork 1, and then that's their front lines over there. And this is the battlefield. Eventually, this is where they would tell men to go across.
Communicating trench. To your left is a rebuilt trench dug to protect advancing troops from shell fire. Heavy in this open area. The trench followed a zigzag pattern so as to keep a bank of earth between the man and the trenches and British cannonading. How do you say that word?
Cannonading.
Cannonading? Whatever. Second siege line. The low earthworks on each side are part of the French and American advance line. Construction was started when Allied arterial fire had sufficiently weakened the British defense. The line was completed after the capture of redoubts 9 and 10.
This battery here that we're looking at, nope, not battery. This earth fort has been kind of eroded over time due to just nature taking its course. This was one of the two locations that Washington actually decided to capture. He didn't think that attacking Yorktown straight on would be a good cause for his troops, and so he didn't, but he did attack these locations with men, as well as the French, with Rochambeau. On this line at the siege of Yorktown, at night, the battalions of Hamilton and Lawrence of the Light Infantry Division of Major General Marquis de Lafayette, where we get like our Lafayette from, under the command of Lieutenant Colonel Alexander Hamilton, with unloaded muskets and fixed bayonets, scaled the parapets and gallantly captured redoubt number 10, which formed the extreme left outline defense of the British, and so hastening the surrender of Yorktown and the last fighting of troops of General George Washington.
This is redoubt 10, huh?
Yep. And you can see they kind of have it blocked off. Looks like you used to be able to walk back here. This is obviously, they said in the video that they had put, there was four cannons on here, but it was kind of been lost to time. They tried to recreate them a little bit. Basically four cannons here, one facing each, specifically protecting the James River. And you can kind of see the, where they put the fences is kind of where the men would be. Some deer right there. As Quinn's not happy because we are in three of them, four of them?
Three.
And the sun, yeah, she was not happy. So after the French and American forces took out redoubts 9 and 10, then the Americans had their batteries here. Grand American batteries had 7 18-pounder siege guns, 3 24-pounder siege guns, 8 mortars, and 4 howitzers. And we have just a few examples here of what their battery looked like. And basically after the Americans set up their battery and the combined bombardment of the second line of the French and the Grand American battery, later that day sent out the surrender flag. Big old things, jeez. Imagine those things coming at you. And I believe this is the second redoubt right here. Yeah. And this looks more like a, what you'd consider a fort to look like. The French and the Americans took this, both of them, without firing any weapons. They took it with empty muskets. Empty muskets. That's insane. And the reason is, took both of them, they didn't want to give away what they were doing. So we're going to get a good look at this one here. The previous readout, readout 10 that we saw earlier, some of it was in the sea or in the river. 120 British and German forces in here. Germans, notorious for being paid soldiers. And 400 French and American took this. I mean, that's all this was. Can see where the two main cannons would be. And they were looking out at, you can see where we originally were over there. That was the original French battery. Yorktown is just to our right there. This is the push out of the British lines. And their other main cannon, because there's only two cannons in this battery, or in this readout. Second one was right here. And this one was probably one that was feared the most by the French and Americans. Very cool. This one was put there in the 1930s. Imagine 120 guys in here. About 8 o'clock at night when they took it. And then once they took this, the Americans basically used this against Yorktown. Once they had this, it was basically all over. Okay, this is Moore House. This is the house where, after Cornwallis agreed to surrender, he sent some lieutenant generals, Washington sent some lieutenant generals, and they basically worked out the surrender deal between, I believe there was four altogether, generals of the army. And it was weird because they were basically deciding on like what music was going to be played and would the army have full honors, the British Army. And they didn't let them because earlier in the war, a battle was won by the British and they didn't give them any rights that would give the Americans any, I guess, honor. That sounds such a like a weird concept. There's no honor and loss, right? Looks like if it wasn't COVID, we probably have went in. There's restrooms right there, so I assume they meant for you to stay here a little longer. What's this? And this is the field that the British marched out on and presented George Washington the Sword of Cornwallis, and Washington did not actually accept it because Cornwallis himself did not come out. He said he was ill. Sounds like cowardice to me. Looks like I was going in the wrong way here. So we're heading up now this way to see the battlefield where the British officially surrendered. And Cornwallis had one of his lieutenant generals try to give up his sword, and Washington refused it because he wasn't the right person to give it to him. It's a pretty cool little building here. General George Washington, I have the honor to inform Congress that a reduction of the British Army under the command of Lord Cornwallis is most happily effected. 1781.
Lieutenant General Charles Lord Cornwallis, I have the mortification to inform Your Excellency that I have been forced to give up the post of York and Gloucester and to surrender the troops under my command by capitulation on the 19th instant as prisoner of war to the combined forces of America and France, to General Sir Henry Clinton, Commander-in-Chief, British Forces in America.
Okay, some things that are left here are some trophies of war. I don't know if these are the real deal. They look pretty nice. They look like they may be. Washington said that around 244 pieces of artillery were captured at Yorktown. And here are some of them. And they even say on there, I'm thinking they are surrendered by the capitulation of Yorktown. Capitulation. I gotta get that right. Look at these things. These are all cannons. I don't know, they just sound say surrender. So that 250 years later, I can't say it. On October 19, 1781, the now paved road on your right was lined by American soldiers on the right and French soldiers on the left. Every eye was trained upon the arrival of the British troops. Spectators from miles around crowded behind the military formation in anticipation of the British parade. Washington had ordered Cornwallis to march his men from Yorktown at precisely 2 p.m., but unforeseen delays held their exit until 3 p.m. Cornwallis sent word that he was ill and appointed Brigadier General Charles O'Hara to lead his troops. In solemn steps with arms shoulder and colors cased, the British and German prisoners marched with drums, beating to this field, where they surrendered their weapons. The victors and the defeated were unaware that the long struggle had ended. That's a cool pic. Lots of trees here now, but this picture would depict that there was no trees. Again, 250-ish, a little less than years. Sounds like Cornwallis got the good end of this. He was sent back to England. The king didn't disgrace him. He basically heaped praises on him. I say that all while some of his men, about 7,000 of his men, were captured and basically marched to Pennsylvania. Some died along the way. Some died of disease, obviously, and some were just there for another 2 years because the war lasted for two more years. And then they got to go home. While Cornwallis was just sitting high and tidy back in England. Okay, now we're standing at a location where Washington set up his headquarters for the attack of Yorktown. And the reason why he put it here is because it was right at the head of the French camp and the American camp. So that's why it is where it is. Smart fella, right?